never know. And I love, well, I love the whole scripture, but I love the book of Romans. The book of Romans is the most comprehensive, systematic of the Christian statement of the Christian faith. It is the most comprehensive and systematic statement of the Christian faith. And in Romans, I mean, you can witness to somebody just using the book of Romans, the Romans wrote. I mean, it is packed full of doctrine, of teaching. And Paul wrote Romans in around AD 58 from Corinth when he was on his third missionary journey. And so, and he wrote this not because, now he's never been to Rome. Okay, and we're going to see that, and even in his statements in the letter, he's wishing to go, and he wants to go visit them in Rome. Now, who established Rome? Now, the Catholics think, because where is the Catholic diocese, the big church? It's in Rome, right? They believe Peter founded it, but we know that's not true, because in the end of Romans, let me just show you real quick here to make a point. Romans 15. In verse 20, it says, "Yea, so I have strived to preach the gospel, not where Christ was named, lest I should build upon another man's foundation." And so it wasn't founded by one of the apostles. They believe it was founded, the Roman church was founded by those who became Christians at Pentecost. Remember the, what was it, 3,000 souls that were saved? And they believe that they come from Rome and they went back and they started a church there. But Paul is going to be giving them instruction, apostolic instruction from him, but it is packed full of information. I mean, the wrath of God, you know, and God's love for us and our salvation. I mean, it is an awesome, awesome book. Now, listen to these three things. I got this stuff here. I got from who was the gentleman's name that I got? Oh yeah, David Guzik. But listen to what it says. And these are some things that happened in history from some people that read the book of Romans. And I thought this was very interesting. And I thought, I think you guys might too. In the summer of 386, a young man wept in the backyard of a friend. He knew that his life of sin and rebellion against God was killing him, leaving him empty, but he just couldn't find the strength to make a final, real decision for Jesus Christ. As he sat, he heard some children playing a game, and they called out to each other these words, "Take up and read, take up and read." Thinking God had a message to him through the words of the children, he picked up a scroll laying nearby, opened it, and began to read. Not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery or lasciviousness, not in quarreling or jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. Romans 13:13-14. He didn't read any further. He didn't have to. Through the power of God's word, Augustine had faith to entrust his whole life to Jesus Christ at that moment. Another one, in August of 1513, a monk lectured on a book of Psalms in a seminary, but his inner life was nothing but turmoil. In his study, he came across Psalms 31:1. "In thy righteousness, deliver me." The passage confused him. How could God's righteousness do anything but condemn him to hell as a righteous punishment for his sins? Luther kept thinking about Romans 1:17, which says that in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed through faith for faith. And it is written, "He who through faith is righteous shall live." Habakkuk. That's the word. 22:4. The monk went on to say, night and day I pondered until I grasped the truth that righteousness of God is a righteousness whereby through grace and sheer mercy he justifies us by faith. Therefore I felt myself to be reborn and have gone through the open doors of paradise. The passage of Paul becomes to me a gateway into heaven. Martin Luther was born again and the Reformation began in his heart. The breakaway from the Catholic Church. And here's the last one here. May of 1738, a failed minister and missionary went unwilling to a small Bible study where someone read aloud from Martin Luther's commentary on Romans. As the failed missionary said later, while he was describing the change with God works in the heart through Christ and faith in Christ, I felt my heart strangled warm. I felt I did trust in Christ, Christ alone for my salvation and assurance, and was given me that he had taken my sins away, even mine. John Wesley was saved that night in London. Look at these testimonies from just the book of Romans. People picking up the book and coming to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. It's a powerful, powerful book. And that God gave Paul to write to the Romans. Martin Luther praised the book of Romans. It is the chief part of the New Testament and the perfect gospel, the absolute epitome of the gospel. Philip Melanchthon called Romans the condemnum of Christian doctrine. John Calvin said of Romans, when anyone understands this epistle, he has a passage open to him into the understanding of the whole scriptures. F.G. Campbell Morgan said, Roman was the most pessimistic page of literature upon which your eyes ever rested, and at the same time, the most optimistic poem to which your ears have ever listened. And on it goes. And so I thought those were very neat on those who got saved. A lot of the Christian leaders of the faith through history getting saved by just reading the book of Romans, coming to that same knowledge of Jesus Christ. And so we're going to take a look at the first seven verses today. So we should get out of here by at least two. So, it took us an hour to get through three. So let's figure it out, okay? But anyway, let's take a look at Romans 1 through 7. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised before by his prophet in the whole scriptures, concerning the Son of Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name. Among whom are ye also the called of Jesus Christ to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And so look at here with Paul as he starts out. He's writing to the Romans and he's saying who he is. And notice what he says first. He says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ. He didn't say, Paul, the apostle, a servant of Jesus Christ. He's a servant of Jesus Christ. And what does servant mean? It's doulos, bond servant. It means slave, subservient. Okay, he wants to serve the one who died for him. And that's what all Christians need to be, is servants of the living God. Because we serve somebody down here, don't we? Right? If you have a job, you have a boss, right? And you serve that boss. The boss tells you to do something, what do? You do it. You don't do it, guess what? There's the door. Out you go. Fired. F-I-R-E-D. So long. Sayonara. Out. And you get paid. Sometimes we get underpaid.
underpaid down here, don't we? Very underpaid. They pack it all up on us and everything. And some of us are doing two or three jobs. I always tell people, well, if you're doing this person's job and this person's job, shouldn't you get like three paychecks? I mean, doesn't it work that way? I mean, how many jobs you do, John? Too many, right? You get paid for each job title you hold?